Welcome to Algebra 1AB. Today we've got section 9.4. If you can believe it, we've only got a couple sections left in this class for the whole year. So let's end this year the right way. And really this chapter that we're going into is really a nice extension of what we covered in 9.1 through 9.3 when we just tested over that. Our goals for that section, if you remember, we're trying to find solutions to quadratics either by using square roots or by graphing. Okay, so we're going to continue that with a process called completing the square. Now, 9.4 is going to be split up into 4 days worth of lessons, and that's because it is a process that requires a fair amount of steps, and I want to be sure that every time we learn a new step in the process, that we're able to connect it to what we've covered already. So we're just going to literally go one step at a time and hopefully understand this completing the square and what it does for us in a really comprehensive way and understand it really well. All right, so let's get started. We just finished 9.3, which was using square roots to solve quadratic equations. That's where we're going to pick up. So now you can see that we still do have a quadratic. I do still have inside parentheses a variable being squared. But you can see that it's not just the variable being squared, there's also a plus 8 in there. The instructions say to solve using square roots, so that's exactly what I'm going to do. If I want to end up with n equals something, I first need to get rid of the square that's applying to that quantity containing n. So I will square root both sides. And as we've said in the past, on the left, the square root cancels out the square, and I prefer you show that canceling. Now we have n plus 8 equals, on the right, it's a square root 25 still. I didn't have something squared that the square root cancels out, so the square root stays. Now, since we are the ones square rooting both sides, the square root was not shown initially, we have to indicate that it could be a positive or negative result. So we need that plus or minus sign put in right there. Now, next, what I like to look for is I want to simplify that square root. So I'm going to look and say, okay, is it a perfect square? If I don't know my perfect squares, I might try this in a calculator and see if it comes out cleanly. If it doesn't come out cleanly, or if it's not a perfect square, then I'm going to use the tower method. In this case, I know that 25 is a perfect square number. So I know that n plus 8 equals plus or minus, and instead of the square root 25, I know that means the same thing as 5. So I'll simplify it. And now to finish solving for n, I'm going to subtract 8 from both sides. Now when we have something like this happens, we have a positive or negative 5, and then we are subtracting 8 from it, I prefer you write this step first. N equals negative 8, and then the plus or minus 5. Put that number that you've moved to the other side of the equation, put that out in front of the plus or minus sign. It's just kind of a nice reminder that that sign is there, and that we're going to have to find two separate answers to this equation, two solutions. Okay, so now we're at the point where we can actually evaluate it. I know that I'm going to have a case where it's negative 8 plus 5, and another case where it's negative 8 minus 5. That's how we deal with that plus or minus sign. Well, negative 8 plus 5 is negative 3. Negative 8 minus 5 is negative 13. So my solution set contains negative 3 and negative 13. And again, the order that you list those doesn't matter as long as we're including both of them. Here's a similar problem to the last example. I'd like you to pause the video and try this on your own. I will check back in a few seconds with my solution. All right, so hopefully, just like in the last example, trying to get to that variable n, so we will square root both sides. On the left, square root cancels out square, and we just have n minus 2. On the right, we did take the square root, so we need to put plus or minus there, and it is still the square root of 16. N minus 2 equals plus or minus the square root of 16 is another perfect square, that's 4. And then we add 2 to both sides. So n equals 2 plus or minus 4. Well, 2 plus 4 or 2 minus 4, I get a positive 6 or a negative 2. So my solution set is positive 6 and negative 2. Very procedural, and it's really nice how this builds on the previous section. All right, example 5, here you can see a very similar setup. However, it's not just x plus something inside parentheses or x minus something inside parentheses. Now it's 2x. Well, that just adds one more solution step at the very end. It really doesn't complicate things for us too much. We're still trying to undo that square, that second power first, so I will square root both sides. Square root cancels out that second power on the left, and I just have 2x minus 5. On the right, I did square root both sides, so plus or minus square root of 49. Let's try to simplify square root of 49. Hey, that's a perfect square number. Square root of 49 is 7, so 2x minus 5 equals plus or minus 7. Now let's finish solving for x. I'm going to add 5 to both sides. So I have 2x equals 5 plus or minus 7. And then we'll divide both sides by 2. And I want to be careful. I'm dividing everything over here by 2, so I'm just going to write that as a big fraction. Now let's split up our two solutions. I had 5 plus 7, and then all that divided by 2. I had 5 minus 7, and all that divided by 2. 5 plus 7 is 12. And then that gets divided by 2. 5 minus 7, negative 2. That gets divided by 2. So when I actually finish up those divisions, oops, we don't have n now, we have x. My solution set is 12 divided by 2 is 6. Negative 2 divided by positive 2 is negative 1. There we have it. Problem number 6, look, our instructions have changed a little bit. Solve each equation by taking square roots. Write irrational solutions. If a solution is irrational, it means that it's not a perfect square number. We're going to end up with some type of square root left in our answer. Write those irrational solutions both in simplified radical notation. Okay, we're going to annotate our notes here. Simplified radical notation means we use what we call the tower method to simplify, as well as using a decimal rounded to the nearest hundredth. So I'm going to show you how to type these into your calculator to get the decimal answers as well as the radical ones. But it's weird. You think that a calculator means it's easier to get to the answer or faster to get to the answer. It's actually more work because we have to take the time to type it in carefully. So let's go through the process, and then again, I'll show you how to type this into a calculator at the very end. Steps stay very much the same. I'm going to start by square rooting both sides here. I need to undo that square if I want to get to x, undo that second power. Square root will do just that. So I have x minus 11 equals, we did square root, so plus or minus root 15. Okay, can I simplify square root 15? I like to take care of this step early if possible. Well, no, I type it into a calculator. I know that 15 is not a perfect square. It doesn't come out clean in the calculator. So let's try to make a tower out of that. I can divide the prime number 3 out of 15. 15 divided by 3 is 5, and 5 is prime. So the square root of 15 is the square root of 3 times 5. And I don't have any getaway driver, any pair of factors under there that will cancel out the square root. Square root 15 is already simplified. Okay, so I don't need to adjust that square root 15. I'll just leave it as it is. Now I add 11 to both sides. I still need to finish solving for x. But I get x equals 11 plus or minus root 15. And now because this is irrational, that square root 15 did not come out cleanly, I'm done. My answer is acceptable at this point. 11 plus or minus root 15 is it. All right, well, now let's take this over and find some decimal answers to represent that. So the first one, I would have x equals 11 plus, and then in the calculator, square root of 15. And your calculator may extend the radical, like when you open up a square root, it may let you type underneath, or it may do something like this, where it opens up a set of parentheses, which we would, you know, put 15 in parentheses and then close it. Either way, what these are going to produce is an answer of 14.87. All right. Well, now we just need to go through and find the case. Well, what if it were 11, not plus, but minus square root of 15? And again, we'll type that into the calculator, whatever way the calculator handles it, whether it's parentheses or just letting you type in the square root. And here what we get is, what is it, 7.13. So here are the two decimal answers. Okay, not too much work. And again, a lot of that writing is just how to type it into the calculator. Once you have that answer that's boxed up on the left, the one that's in simplified radical notation, really you can just go straight to your decimals there. There's not a lot of work that I need to see shown. It's just, do you know how to type it in the calculator? And since we're taking notes, why not show those steps? Right, our final example. This is very similar to the last example. I'd like you to pause the video now, try this on your own, and I'll check back in a few seconds with my solution. All right, so as we've seen all day, we want to undo that second power. Let's square root both sides. On the left, it cancels out beautifully. 2x plus 7 then equals plus or minus the square root of 8. Okay, simplified radical notation, let's handle that first. That is the fastest way to do it. So I'm going to make a little tower for 8 and see if I can't break that up. Do I have a getaway driver hidden underneath there? I can divide 8 by the prime number 2 and I'll get 4. And 4 I can divide by 2 as well. 4 divided by 2 is 2. So my square root 8 is really the square root of, let's look at the numbers outside the tower, 2 times 2 times 2. Okay, and we have a getaway driver, 2 square root 2. So now back to our equation, 2x plus 7 equals plus or minus 2 square root 2. Let's finish solving for x. I'm going to subtract 7 from both sides. 2x equals negative 7, then my plus or minus 2 root 2. And then finally, I'm going to divide everything by 2 to cancel out the 2 times x. My final answer in simplified radical notation is this. Even though that looks pretty monstrous, that is the solution. Now let's find the decimals that go along with it. So the first one, x equals. Now, I want to handle everything that's happening in the numerator inside a set of parentheses. I'm going to do that addition and subtraction first, then divide all of that by 2. So inside parentheses, I'll take that negative 7 plus 2 square root 2, and then divided by 2. And I should get a decimal answer that I believe, let me check this really quickly. I believe it's negative 2.09, but I just want to make sure. Negative 7 plus 2 square root 2, all of that divided by 2, and I get negative 2.09 once it's rounded. Okay, and then my other solution is going to be the same exact thing, except it's negative 7 minus. That's the only thing that changes. That plus turns to a minus. Okay, and that equals, I believe it's negative 4.91, but I'm just going to go back and check. Type that all in, change the plus to a minus. Negative 4.91 is the correct answer. So those are our two decimal answers rounded to the nearest hundredth. All right, there you have it. That is section 9.4, day one. And remember, we're just going to take this one step at a time to ultimately build this process we call completing the square. All right, hope we've got this last chapter of Algebra 1AB off to a good start.